Okay, in this report, I will be discussing one of the previous committee report on criminal justice reform in India, and this is from March of 2003, as you can see here. And this report was generated under the chairmanship of Dr. Justice V.S. Malimath. So commonly, it can also be known as the Justice Malimath report. And let's have a quick look. I have noted down some page numbers, and I will show you the important highlights from this report, because it will give a sense of history, and it will also let us know that many of the things people are asking for even today, they were already being discussed in the year 2000 till the year 2003. And I saw this sentence in the beginning of the report, which is very apt. It says, "Everything has been said already, but as no one listens, we must always begin again." So let's have a look at the report. I have noted down some page numbers. I will jump to them and show you the details. So we can see this was done by constituted by Ministry of Home Affairs in November of 2000, and the report came in the year 2003. That gives you a sense of the amount of work involved in this overhaul of the criminal justice system. At that point of time, it took almost like 3 years. So one of the points I am showing is, so basically they were discussing even whether there is a need to rewrite the Code of Criminal Procedure, the Indian Penal Code, and the Indian Evidence Act. And in fact, into 2020, these three exactly are the areas which I have covered in my previous video. So you can see that the mandate exists for three areas of laws, and basically substantive criminal law, which is the IPC, and then the CRPC, and then the law of evidence. So the similar were the goals even at that time. And some of the things have been always been discussed in the media and in the press, and the demands of the public. So basically pendency of trial, investigation, and prosecution, police, judiciary accountable for delays. So that's a never go it never goes out of fashion. So it was still a problem now, it was a problem even then. Let me take you to page 14, and I have highlighted some points here. So basically, what was the modus operandi adopted by the committee at that time? So what they said was, so have a look at this and try to compare what is being done now in 2020. So basically, they prepared a questionnaire and obtained responses from all walks of society, organized seminars, participate in seminars, meet citizens from different states, from different walks of life. So it was not only relegated to or limited to high court judges and various functionaries like state governments and senior advocates and things like that, or heads of police. So even the citizens were involved. So let me show you page number 15. So when I say page number 15, it is page number 15 as per the, you can see at the bottom of the PDF. The actual page number in the document might be different one. So for convenience, of my own convenience, I am typing the page numbers as per the the PDF document. Now let us see. The questionnaire was prepared and sent to 3,000 some persons, enclosing a prepaid envelope. However, the number of responses received is only 284, and this 3,000 people were the functionaries of government and judiciary, chief secretaries, law secretaries, chief ministers, home minister, law minister. So yesterday I said in my previous video that in a country of population of 140 crores or so, a few hundred people reply, and that was the case then, and probably it will be the same even now. Okay, and there are various observations that other states have not responded in spite of repeated requests. So basically, do not take it that if a law commission or some kind of a committee on reform asks for inputs, then everybody will respond. Everybody did not respond, and they did not respond even then. So let me take you to page number 28. I have a list of pages actually. So Justice V.R. Krishna Iyer, he expresses anguish in May of 1999, and there are various lamentations about the criminal justice system and all that stuff. So I'm just showing it to give a sense of history that these things were being discussed even then. And then, this is an interesting coverage of topics in this report if people are interested. So basically, there are two major systems in the criminal law. One is adversarial and one is inquisitorial system. And then there's a discussion of, what's the inquisitorial system and adversarial system. And in India, we follow the adversarial system in both criminal and civil law. So I'm just giving it just in case somebody is interested to find out more details on on both of them. And coming to how many people responded. So the High Courts of Jharkhand and Uttaranchal have opined that the adversarial system has failed. Then there is scope for improving the adversarial system by adopting some of the useful features of inquisitorial system. So, there is a debate which was going on even at that time whether, the system we have adopted, is it good or bad. So let me show another para here, which is, I think, just here. Yeah. So one of the previous ex-presidents of India, Dr. R. Venkataramanan, there is observation. The adversarial system is the opposite of our ancient ethos. In the panchayat justice, they were seeking the truth, while in adversarial procedure, the judge does not seek the truth. So I have an observation of my own, actually. My sense is that the system of law we follow in India, people actually are not really, take to it as naturally. People are more comfortable with some kind of a panchayat or some kind of a, community meeting or that kind of system. We haven't really taken to this Anglo-Saxon mode of system, which has been come to us from the British. It has been, adopted, but I don't think it has been understood by the public. So that is my own point on this. Let me take you to page number 120. And now, very interestingly, this report was in 2003. It's even at that time they were saying, when the video audio, there were no smartphones at that time. Of course, video cameras were there to record and all that. So it says, video audio recording of witnesses and confessions, and of course, dying declarations. I think even today, in circumstances, they are video recorded. So unfortunately, the existing law does not provide for it. I'm not sure of the current laws, but I don't think it's. I mean, it's not a. It can be done on a special court order. As far as I know, even in the current CRPC or Code of Civil Procedure, there is an automated way of, video recording. And if you see some of these TV serials and movies of from Hollywood, they will be showing depositions going on in video recording, even in the lawyer's offices. So you don't need to go to the court to have a deposition, evidence recorded. So I don't know why it is taking such a long time to do the same in India, when we have such a huge pendency of cases. So let me jump to page number 148, and now this is about complaints about within the judicial system. So basically, it says judges who do not attend the court punctually, judgments are not pronounced for time, cases are heard and then they are kept in abeyance. Then complaints from the lawyers against some judges. Then complaints about corruption, etc., etc. So these are some of the points that how a chief justice can be given more powers to. Make the quality of the whole judiciary better. So you can have a look at it in detail. Let me jump to page number 165. So this is about, even on social media these days, you see a lot of people are cribbing that why there are such huge time vacation, I mean, court vacations in India, both summer vacation as well as winter vacations and other festivals. So basically, it says that judges in France and USA who interacted with the committee, they said that they do not have vacations. They take leave as per their convenience and they ensure that the courts are still functioning. And there is a bit of history here. So it says the vacation system in India in courts, it's a legacy of the British Raj, basically. And the reason was the vacation was evolved as an arrangement to enable the judges, English judges, to go to England during summer and spend their time over there. So that was the history. So we have to look at it more seriously as to why do we need it as of now. Now this is another point about the amount of fines. If you read the CRPC, it will say that 50 rupees fine, 100 rupees fine for, some, like let's say you send a summons to a witness and he or she doesn't turn up. So these fines amount have not been revised in a long time. So this is the observation of about that by the committee. So let me go to page number 199, and there is a whole set of section on, you know, crimes against women, especially about section 498A of IPC. And even in 2003, you know, there was many observations that at that time it was especially true. It's not so much as of now, that upon a complaint, the husband, in-laws, and all the relatives, I mean, lot of relatives of the husband would be arrested immediately. And then there are more observations. You can look in detail. So the recommendation, what the committee is thinking about in this, I will show the recommendation in detail later on. It says it's necessary to make this offense bailable and compoundable. Now, as of the fact is that it is not compoundable and bailable as of today. And my feeling is even if you make it compoundable and bailable, it will solve some problems, but it will have, you know, fresh set of problems after that. So let me jump to page number 271, and there, you know, we have to start with the recommendation in part number 6. So if people who are more interested in, you know, what were the recommendations of the committee, they can straight away jump to part 6 of the report. Let me show you page 280, and basically this is a recommendation which has been, whenever I read various news reports in press and, you know, newspapers, so this is a very common complaint as well as suggestion that the investigation wing, basically the IO, the investigation officer, he should be part of the separate, you know, from the law and order wing. People, you know, the policemen who are like beat constables and other officers who have to maintain the law and order on a daily basis, the investigation should be a separate department. So because as of now, they are the same. Let me show you page 282 as per document. So basically it says audio video recording, you know, should be made authorized by the law. And then interrogation centers should be at each district, and video and photos, I mean, videography and photography should be, the facilities should be there at these centers. So all this was done even in 2003. Now this is about the, you know, fine amount. Like I said, you know, 50 rupees, 100 rupees fines. So basically, this recommendation, I think it's good. Increase the fine amount to 2,000, then in another section, increase to 5,000. But I feel this is again the same problem that in a country like India, where the inflation rate, even now it is still high, you know, maybe 5 to 7%. So probably there should be a way to increase them automatically as per the inflation. So let me show you page number 293. And so there is a section 344 of the Criminal Procedure Code, which is for, you know, taking cognizance of a false statement to the court by a witness. So this recommendation was that, you know, in 344.1, you delete this line. You know, basically it gave a, you know, power to the judge so that, you know, he could, only if he is satisfied that this is necessary and expedient in the interest of justice, that then only he or she will try, you know, the false witness. So if I look at the CRPC as of today, this line is still there. So if satisfied, you know, so basically it has not been amended. And I think this is one of the major problems, that some of these, you know, clauses which should be, there should not be too much discretion. If a crime has been done against the court or against the judicial system, then it should be, you know, punished immediately. So this is the problem why false cases cannot be prosecuted easily. Now let me show you page 298, which is about crimes against women and you know, those kind of crimes. So basically there was a recommendation, you know, section 497 of IPC adultery, basically it has been declared unconstitutional by the Supreme Court in judgment which was just 1 or 2 years back. Now in this committee's recommendation, what they said was, as of now, the at that time, the crime was that only a man could be prosecuted. So what they said was, it is not a balanced way of justice. So basically they said that even a wife, you know, even a woman should be punished, basically, you know, if she has sexual intercourse with another married man. So at that time they had the thought process that instead of, you know, making it not an offense at all, they should make it a crime for both men and women to make some kind of a gender equality, basically. So that was at that time, and times have changed. Let's look at page page number 299, and basically it says that section 498A should be made billable and compoundable. I think it will create fresh set of problems because, you know, there is something called always a law of unintended effects. You solve one problem, but it may create some more problems. But that's a topic for another day. Let me show the current committee for reforms in criminal laws, and I have already covered it in another video. And today I'm seeing, you know, from yesterday itself, there's a change in the website. Yesterday, this, you know, bottom ticker was not there. And as of now, there is some kind of invitation to participate in expo. That's the old one, I think. And then there is a call for application for internship. So basically, I think the committee is asking for interns for 2 months plus extendable by another 2 months for, you know, helping the committee with all this process of criminal law reforms. And they have a set of what I'm surprised is that, you know, they say that I thought this will be a paid internship, but it says the provision of stipend is subject to exceptional performance. And well, I mean, let's hope somebody gets that stipend at least. So I think that's all I have to say in this for today. And this report is, you know, very useful. I'll again show you, maybe I will upload it, the link, you know, share in my on Twitter and various social media. So basically, this is the 2003 report by Justice Malimuth on the criminal justice system. And my advice is that, you know, at least this highlighted portions, everybody should read and get a good sense of grip on, you know, how there is already a sense of history and recommendations which have been given earlier. So if you want to make any recommendations now, it is better to, you know, go through the history first, because you might be making the same mistakes otherwise, which may not be you know, feasible or practicable to implement. And then whatever effort you have done in submitting your responses to the committee, you know, the current committee on IPC or CRPC, that whole effort, a lot of that effort may just go waste. So it's my strongly, you know, I suggest that one should read this report. I will upload it. And let's hope that we are able to give good suggestions to the committee.